Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Steel Dragon 5 by Kevin McLaughlin and Michael Anderle, narrated by Emily Beresford. Chapter 1. The view from under the palm tree was stunning, Kristen thought, as she burrowed her toes in the hot white sand of the beach. The sun had begun to sink below the horizon and was gradually swallowed by the crystal clear blue water of the bay. On either side of their small private harbor, more huge-leafed tropical trees shaded flowers and exotic birds that called in excitement at the last rays of sun of the day. She would have liked to be able to enjoy the scenery, but that wasn't exactly possible when camping out in an enemy base. It was even more difficult when trying to prevent a group of technomages from escaping via magical means. Most importantly, they could not be allowed to access the huge cache of weapons they had stored there that could kill dragons as easily as lead could punch holes in humans. It seemed ironic that people came to islands like this and paid top dollar to eat tropical fruit and fresh fish from the ocean. Her people did those things merely to survive. Stonequest flew in from the ocean, a massive tuna in the claws of each of his hind legs. Oh, she sighed with relief. At least they wouldn't go without a meal later. The night before had been sleepless, as well as foodless. They had won a great battle, but it wasn't exactly reassuring to incarcerate a group of mages in their own cells. None of them had cooperated either. She knew there had to be food rations stashed somewhere in the World War II complex of tunnels dug into this tropical volcanic island, but none of the prisoners would say where. Despite Constance Vigil, the former leader of the Technomages, advocating for them all to work together and helping them survive the battle when she could have turned it against them, she claimed she didn't know where any of the food was. "Any luck with getting intel from Eric?" Kristen asked Jim as they watched Stonequest butcher the tuna with his dragon claws.
"Nah, he's not talking about a damn thing," he said.
"Not even to the Wonder Kid?" she teased.
Jim smiled his Wonder Kid smile.
"I don't think they've heard that I have a reputation to maintain." "I have good news," Keith said as he emerged from the jungle. He held a massive cordless phone.
"You've found a weapon we can use to kill the mages one by one if we need to?" Hernandez asked. She had spent her time off building sandcastles, filling them with explosives, and blowing them apart.
"No." The rookie was unshaken by the gallows humor. "But I do have someone who wants to talk to you, boss."
He handed the massive phone to Kristen, and she put it to her ear.
"Hello?"
"Oh, dear God, Kristen! I'm so glad to hear your voice!"
"Brian!"
she shouted with delight, instantly encouraged by her brother's voice.
"We're on the job. Call me Zed."
"You called me Kristen. Shouldn't that be Lady Steel, Zed?" she replied.
"Okay, that's a fair point. I'll call you the Queen of the Dragons if you want. Huh, I'm only glad to finally talk to you. How did you manage? I saw the plane crash and the satellite feed made it look very bad. The water's clear enough to see the damage. Are you guys okay? Are the Technomages dead or gone?"
"One question at a time," Kristen said, although she found his optimism contagious. She knew, logically, that they had been in far more danger than him, but it still felt good to hear his voice.
"Right, right, right,"
Brian said and attempted to regain control of his composure.
"Let's keep it professional. What's your status and how can I help?"
"The main concern is that we found more dragons who were imprisoned here and who need serious help. Lumos is trying his best with them, but they're not doing too well. On top of that, we have captives as well."
"The mages?"
She nodded instinctively before she remembered she was talking on a bigger phone than her head.
"Yeah, some died, but we ended up taking a good number prisoner."
"And the leaders?"
"All shackled."
She couldn't help but chuckle.
"Constance, Katrina, Havington, who was the douche from Europe, and the local boss, Eric."
"Not too shabby."
"It's not only them," Kristen explained. "There are many rank and file mages too, plus regular human soldiers who were loyal to their cause. We have them all under guard, but we barely have the personnel to do it. Plus, it's their base. I'm scared shitless that they know back doors we don't."
"Okay, well, I have someone who wants to talk about getting you out of there and, believe it or not, has already started the process," Brian said.
"How is that possible? We just started talking."
"I sent your team to that island, remember? and I saw your plane go down. We've been watching from the skies and haven't seen any boats leave, so we assumed you'd still be there.
Who do you mean by we?
Hello, Lady Steel. It's Amethyst. I'm glad young Zed has finally reached you through the telephones.
Amethyst, unless this is something urgent, I need to continue my conversation with my intelligence officer.
The old dragon sucked a breath in. I fear we're not the only people who know about your position and what transpired on that island. Things have changed.
What things?
She asked, not at all liking that Amethyst was being less than direct. Usually, she was relaxed and open, but she seemed jittery.
Rumors, movements. Detroit seems still. I don't like it.
Kristen frowned.
Is there something you need to tell me?
She hoped a direct question might compel the ancient dragon to simply spit it out.
I have chartered a ship to come and get all of you. A yacht, in fact, and a fast one from a billionaire in Japan. But I feel it will still be too slow. Is there no way you can get home faster?
Amethyst, she tried to sound patient. What exactly is going on? She felt certain the old dragon was hiding something now. It was not a pleasant feeling.
I don't have anything specific, Amethyst admitted. Merely a feeling that things are shifting, you could say.
You chartered a racing yacht because you had a feeling? She took a breath and tried not to get frustrated.
My duties have kept me at home with the dragons you have rescued. But as I said, there are rumors. Many dragons have left populated areas. Some would say fled.
They might be simply nervous. They can't know that we finally captured most of the technomages. The last they saw of them was an attack on Detroit.
And if that was all I'd noticed, I wouldn't be worried. But in the light of a recent attack, I would think dragon SWAT teams would increase patrols. But this is not the case.
No? A pit grew relentlessly in her stomach, as if a demon of dread was scooping her insides out.
No, Amethyst said flatly. Most of them are no longer at their duty stations. I haven't heard about any training exercises either. They're all simply gone, someplace else. The whole thing stinks. I can feel it thick in the air, like the calm before a storm.
The demon in her stomach dug the hole even deeper, but she didn't want to convey her concern to Amethyst.
I don't think you understand.
Kristen tried to sound firm. We've defeated the bad technomages. It should be done now. There's no one left to attack.
Believe me, my dear. I am quite relieved that you have finally managed to capture the brutes who performed these barbaric acts on the poor dragons who now call my estate home. However, I am not sure this is the kind of thing that ends so easily.
The old dragon sighed.
Although you and your team have done admirably, it cannot be denied and is now quite obvious that humans are a clear and present danger to dragonkind. There were many who wished to end your kind when you discovered how to build castles to defend yourselves against us. Later, there were dragons who wished to end your existence when you learned how to fly with your machines, and others who saw the atomic bomb as the final straw. Truly, that would have been the end if not for your uncharacteristic restraint with the weapon. But for many, this is too much. With these bullets harvested from our own kind, any human can now kill a dragon. This has not escaped us.
But how can dragons truly think they'll benefit if they have a war with humans? She asked. Amethyst tisked.
Not all of this is about logic, my dear. Dragons are ruled by their emotions as much as humans. Perhaps more so as we have auras to communicate and influence each other with. I agree with you, of course, that this must all be avoided. But it seems to me as if someone sees their chance evaporating. With every day that passes, the threat of humans rebelling will seem less as the news of your success will spread. That is why you need to be somewhere instead of the middle of nowhere as quickly as possible. Can you think of nothing besides the ship I have sent?
Despite Amethyst being much older than her, and somehow even wealthier than she was with the money she'd inherited from the dragon Windlock, she was an investigator, so she did not need to answer. Make sure the Dragon Council knows of our success here. And Brian, I know you're still listening. Make sure the media starts talking about what happened in Detroit as the last hurrah of these terrorists.
You got it, Brian said.
Of course, my dear, Amethyst said. I'll see what else we can come up with on this end, Kristen added, although she was unsure what they could do. She hoped that news of their success would be enough to calm the factions of dragons who wished to slaughter humanity rather than be served by them. Sadly, she would be lying to herself if she thought it would be enough after all that had happened over the last year. With a heavy sigh, she ended the call.
Plans?
Jim asked. The old dragon's right, she said. We need to get off this island and back to the USA ASAP. Chapter 2. Although her private jet was currently damaged, perhaps irreparably so, and tangled in a coral reef at the bottom of the ocean, Kristen still had hopes that they could get home before anything too terrible happened. It would merely require a little magic, and she had the perfect people to help. She found Larry and Amy standing near one of the entrances to the network of underground tunnels that had been excavated into the island over 50 years before. It looked like a scene out of a sci-fi movie. The girl levitated about 10 feet up on her skateboard, while pebbles floated around her in complex whirls and spirals. One massive boulder was suspended too, and Larry was seated on top of it.
Am I interrupting a training session or something?
Kristen asked loudly. The giant boulder jolted and plummeted, and the mage tumbled off.
Oh, Jesus, Kristen! Don't scare us like that!
Us?
Amy asked, rolled her eyes, and flipped into a series of kicks on the skateboard that would have been absolutely impossible if it had been bound by the laws of gravity. She landed easily, and the pebbles that had hovered around her followed and created complex shapes or wobbly stacks on the ground.
Sorry about that, Larry said and dusted his robes off. Amy was showing me how to increase my power, and I had her practice some finesse drills. What can we do for you?
I want to get everyone home, now if possible, she said.
Well, why not simply click your heels together and tell your fairy godmother to whisk you away?
He asked. I thought maybe the snarky mage who works for me and used a teleportation spell to get me to this island might be able to keep earning his pay. It was Amy who answered.
I'm sorry, Kristen, but that's not possible. Sure it is. You got me here.
She tried to keep a smile on her face. Larry nodded.
Sure, we got you here. Then the damn portal closed and left us all scrambling. And even that nearly killed me.
But Amy, you're stronger. It looks like I've reached my limits, though, the girl said. Seriously, these portals are difficult to make. I think the only way the mages do it is by working in larger numbers than we've realized. It took everything I had to stop that portal from snapping shut and chopping your tail off. Getting you through again might be possible, but getting everyone home? That's not even in the realm of possibility.
Neither is sending you back alone, Larry interjected. I know what you're thinking. It's not like you want to go back to the Motor City because you're worried about missing a show. You think something's wrong, don't you?
Kristen didn't bother to lie about it. I do, yes. Amethyst convinced me that something's happening, and it makes sense that the Masked One would want to strike as soon as possible, so everyone's gut reaction is to blame the Technomages. If only I can go back, fine. He shook his head and put his hands on his hips.
This is what I'm talking about. We won't send you back alone. For all we know, the Masked One might have tortured Amethyst into saying all that, simply to lure you back there. If you get separated from us again, he won't hold back. He'll kill you, and you know that.
And Amethyst potentially being tortured is supposed to make me want to wait the weeks it'll take for the ship to reach us here and get back home?
Larry smirked.
Bad example.
Kristen turned to the other woman. Despite the mage being younger, she was far more powerful. Truly, this decision would be hers.
Tell me you can do something.
Not gonna happen.
Amy folded her arms.
Can't you charter a jet? He asked. Windlock left you everything. It's not like you can't afford it.
I already talked to Brian about that, Kristen explained. We would still need to take a boat to the nearest island with an airport, plus hire the jet and a pilot. It would take days at least.
So we have to enjoy a tropical paradise for a few days. Is that so bad?
He threw his hands up in frustration. It is when we're understaffed, have dangerous prisoners, and the outside world is getting soaked in gasoline by someone who wants to play with matches, Kristen snapped.
We can't do the portal, Kristen. I'm sorry, Amy said. Maybe we could do a series of jumps or something? Go from here to another island, take a rest, then do another jump? It would take a day at least, but we could do it. It's too much for the two of us to make the jump in one go.
That's it! Larry exclaimed.
I know that's it. I was explaining that we can't really do it, she said and rolled her eyes again.
No, not that. I mean that two mages could never do it. But we don't only have two mages.
He grinned like a fool. I know you got some mages to join us, but none of them are even as strong as you. No offense, Amy added hastily.
We can use them, and we should, Larry said. But that's not who I'm talking about. What if we get some of the technomages to help? They have more experience with the gates. It is their magic trick, after all. I only learned how to do it secondhand by watching the spells they had created.
But we can't trust them, the girl said. They worked for Constance.
The fighting stopped because of Constance.
Kristen took a deep breath. She already knew what she would do, and she already didn't like it.
But if we could get them to help us, we could make a portal that could get us out of here.
He sounded hopeful.
They probably know ways to use less energy or something, and might have a better idea of how to steer, so to speak. I would never have found the way to this island without that thread of magic Constance left.
It's not worth the risk. Amy folded her arms.
That's not your call to make,
he said, his gaze on Kristen. She had already made her mind up.
Let's talk to Constance.
Chapter 3. Kristen, Larry, and Amy entered the complex of tunnels and followed a winding route to the interior where the cells were. It was odd to have taken control of this enemy base that had obviously been in use by the technomages for decades. They walked through rooms where esoteric diagrams and mad scribblings covered the walls. New spells being developed, Larry explained. Their path took them past rooms that held munitions from when the base was first built. Worst of all, they walked past chambers used to hold dragons captive so the technomages could harvest their body parts to use in the manufacture of their awful bullets. Close by were the work areas where they turned these parts into lethal ammunition. It was extremely uncomfortable to think that, if they were attacked, Kristen and her people were the only ones currently in charge of all these horrible resources. Unfortunately, it could not all simply be destroyed. Not yet, and not if Amethyst was right. Finally, they reached the cells where all the captives were held. Even though they had actively tried to start a world war, and all either had dragon blood or even human blood on their hands, she still didn't like keeping them in these surroundings. She'd been in one of the concrete-floored cells only a few days before, but at least she'd had one to herself. That was a luxury she and her team could not afford the captive mages. Behind rusty bars, seated on cold concrete or leaning against the stone walls, was the Technomage Army. Almost every gaze stared at Kristen, Larry, and Amy as they passed. The only ones who didn't stare at their captors were those who tried to conjure some trace of magic. Even with her right outside, some of the mages didn't stop in their endeavors to harness the abilities that had been taken from them. Larry had acted wisely when he prepared to come to the island to rescue Kristen. Before boarding the private jet that took them here, he had gone to Detroit SWAT headquarters and commandeered every anti-magic bracelet they had in their possession. Now, each technomage was equipped with one. Their magic had been rendered useless, and they couldn't remove the restraint. Only Kristen could, as she'd been the one to put them all on. One mage had managed to remove his forcibly, and his lifeless body had already been taken from the cell and buried at sea. Since then, no one else had tried to break the bracelets. Kristen walked past them all and ignored their attempts at magic, as useless as they were. She finally reached the one person who had a cell to herself, stopped, and looked the woman in the eye.
Hello again, Constance Vigil.
Constance smiled like she'd been invited to tea.
We have to stop meeting like this. Although, I must say, the last time we met with me in a cell was a little nicer,
as the glass of that cell was more picturesque than these rusty old bars. Forgive us your accommodations. They are the best we could manage. The last tenants here didn't exactly prioritize the comforts of their prisoners, she said as a dig at how the technomages had treated the dragons they'd kept there. It's always a shame when new management doesn't improve on the problems of the last owner, isn't it? The woman raised an eyebrow.
Enough of this bullshit, Amy said. It stinks badly enough without it.
We need to know more about the portal magic, Kristen said, and nodded to Larry as he was the one who knew what he needed to ask.
We want to know what kind of shorthand you use in those spells, he said, and sounded like he was talking about how to fix a carburetor with a fellow mechanic, instead of interrogating a prisoner.
We managed to open one, but it took a ton of energy. The way your people have used them shows you have a more efficient process. We want it, if you'd be so kind.
He gave her his most charming smile. The smile the mage returned was as fake as his had been.
Why would the steel dragon need to open a portal? I was under the impression you had vast resources at your disposal. Surely a jet can be chartered.
Jets don't go fast enough, Kristen stated.
But why must you travel so quickly?
The prisoner asked.
That doesn't concern you, Amy said.
Ah, but it does. Knowing the destination is incredibly important when opening a portal. If you are trying to go to a, say, battlefield, for example, and you picture something that has already been destroyed, the results can be disastrous.
How do you know there's a battlefield?
The young mage demanded.
It was merely a guess, given the Steel Dragon's history, Constance told her. Also, I can't imagine what else would compel the three of you to come and ask us for help. Can you even trust us? I thought we were your enemy.
She let her gaze bore into Kristen, willing her to tell her what was going on. The thing was, the steel dragon didn't think of Constance as the enemy. Not anymore. The mage had called for the fighting to stop and left a thread of magic for Larry and Amy to follow. Plus, she'd removed the magic dampening bracelet Kristen had been fitted with when she'd been captured. If any of those three things hadn't happened, she had no doubt that it would be her team crammed in these cells instead of Constance's. Still, she knew she needed to tell her something, but she sure as hell didn't want to tell her everything.
We have reason to believe there will be another attack and want to be in place to stop it.
The woman frowned.
You've stopped all the technomages. There may be a few more out there, but I promise you there are no more major cells. If you think our people will attack, all I need is a cell phone to make sure it doesn't happen.
Kristen ground her teeth and tried to suppress her aura. She wasn't concerned about mages. It was the masked one who had her worried now, and Constance had given her that name. The technomage leader had told her that her entire organization had probably been manipulated by this secret asshole since before it was even founded. She realized that if she wanted her help to stop the masked one, her best bet was to come clean. Her mind made up, she shared what information she had from Amethyst with Constance, and spared no details, as paltry as they were. The woman nodded as she related what the old dragon had said, and her frown deepened all the while.
We'll help you with the portal,
was the first thing she said when the explanation finished.
Just like that? Larry grinned.
Why?
Kristen asked.
Too many of those details sync up with what I thought was going on. If the masked one is trying to cause the war, if a dragon has been behind everything going on from the very beginning, he's not likely to stop because the mages were eliminated. He'll push on with his agenda and simply use different actors for the various parts that must be played should he need to.
So you really will help us?
She asked again.
Where do you wish to go?
The USA. Detroit, probably.
Why?
Constance asked.
I already told—
Yes, you did, and I know your intentions and trust them. But this is the first time many of the mages here have laid eyes on the steel dragon, let alone heard her speak. Why should they follow you? Please tell me. If not for me, then for them.
Because we're on the same side, she said. I know all of you fought to end the tyranny of the dragons. I disagree with your methods, but not your reasons.
I don't want my parents to live in a world where the mood of a dragon could end their lives. Now it seems the dragons, or one of the bastards at least, is ready to start the war he wanted you to fight. The best case scenario is a decimation of the human population. Worst case is complete annihilation. I know all of you fought against me because you thought I was upholding the status quo, but that is not why I fought. I did it only to save lives. The same thing I ask of you today. Many of the mages stared at her as she said this, but a precious few came to the front of their cells and asked how they could help. It would have to be enough. Chapter 4. Back on the beach, Kristen watched carefully while Constance explained to Larry, Amy, a few of the stronger mages from their team, and the two technomages who had agreed to help, how to cast the spell. Although she had tried to explain to both her dragon and human allies that the technomage leader wasn't the threat she once was, they had insisted on precautions. Stonequest was in dragon form, ready to incinerate all of them if needed. Drew and his SWAT teams had guns aimed squarely at the mages' heads. She was impressed that Constance didn't seem to mind. Her two underlings were a little squirmy with the weapons, but their leader acted as if being a trigger away from being blown to pieces was all in a day's work. She assumed that, for the technomages at least, it probably was. The first and most important thing to understand is that this is by no means an easy spell to cast, the woman explained. Getting it started is the most difficult part, and my mages practiced it for many years before we ever dared to use it in combat.
So wherever we end up, that's where we'll be, Larry translated.
It was hard to imagine they could teleport somewhere calmer and more tranquil than the tropical beach they now stood on.
Precisely, Constance said. Furthermore, when most of us go through, we will be drained. Our powers will start to replenish, but we'll need cover when we get through.
Consider that handled, Stonequest growled.
Quite.
She obliged the dragon with a tight smile.
What do you mean, most of us? Amy said.
That is the real secret of the spell, and the only way we've been able to use these portals effectively.
The woman sighed, obviously less than pleased to divulge this secret. After a moment's hesitation, she continued, resolute, if less than excited.
Maintaining these portals for any amount of time longer than a few seconds requires that someone remain in place on the island as an anchor for the gate.
That's bullshit, Amy said. We've chased all your forces through these more than once.
Constance smiled.
You merely thought you did. Most times we escaped you, one brave soul stayed behind.
We would have seen them, Kristen said.
They don't need to be right next to the portal, merely close enough to pour magic into it. I promise you, that is how it is done. But it does depend on the distance and the number of people who have to go through. Short hops and a couple of people can usually happen without an anchor. It depends on how long it has to be held open for. In the battle for Detroit, someone stayed behind in the Motor City and met up with us later. Even when they sprung me from prison, a mage stayed behind to get out on their own.
We never found them, though, Drew said.
Indeed. The mages who stayed behind were always skilled in a far simpler spell. Self-immolation.
Unless you think otherwise, boss, I would guess that will not be necessary today, Larry said.
God, no,
Kristen said, aghast at the commitment her foes had to their cause.
Excellent, he said. In that case, I'll stay behind and serve as the anchor. I'd like to know how, anyway.
I can't ask you to do that,
she responded quickly.
Ask what? To hang out for a week or so on a tropical island and take a cruise on a yacht to Detroit? It doesn't sound too bad to me.
It makes sense, Time Flash said.
Although she'd been with them, Kristen constantly almost forgot about her. She'd spent her time almost exclusively with the dragons who had been held captive on the island.
Someone needs to stay with the captive dragons anyway. I don't think it would be smart to haul them through a portal when the alternative is a nice, calm cruise where we can practice fishing and basic socializing.
I don't know, Kristen said.
Come on, Lady Steel. It'll be fine.
The mage smiled cheerfully.
I'm more of a lover than a fighter anyway, and I have the skill to do this. There is a damn good chance you'll need Amy's firepower more than my finesse. Plus, Time Flash and I can keep an eye on the prisoners until the yacht gets here.
About that. The Technomage turned to Kristen. I already mentioned that when we pass through the portal, we will be drained of our powers. I do not know the particulars of what will be on the other side of this gate, but I have never liked going anywhere unprepared. It would be useful to have a few more troops available to help. If Lady Steel would release the rest of my people, they could bolster our force.
She was not thrilled with the idea of simply freeing the people she'd worked to capture almost since she'd known she was a dragon.
How can I trust them? She asked, and not completely rhetorically.
Frankly, Constance, I barely trust you. The others are not high on my list of people I would trust to babysit.
We'd trust you with our lives as well, the woman pointed out.
You're already trusting your lives to us, Stonequest stated. Letting you free would change that. There is a way to make sure they can't betray us.
Larry rubbed his chin and looked at the Technomage leader. Constance eyed him for a moment before realization flashed in her eyes.
No, she said. No way! It was not a good idea back then, and it's not a good idea now.
What are you talking about? Kristen asked, quite sure she was demonstrating yet again that she had grown up as a regular human and spent less time in the world of dragons and mages than everyone around her.
There's a type of rarely used magic called contractual magic, Larry explained.
The woman scoffed.
Rarely used? More like archaic and outdated.
What is it?
She asked and ignored the snide comment.
It's a binding spell, he explained. Once cast, it creates a bond between two people that cannot be broken. Both sides are forced by the magic to fulfill their end of the bargain in question.
Those who don't are incinerated by the magic if they don't comply, Constance said sourly.
What's the big deal? Amy asked. You said your mages were all trained to light themselves on fire if they were captured. How is this different?
It was a snarky, impolite thing to say. Kristen knew that. But there was also something to it.
The difference is that no one else would hurt those mages. That was their choice. And we always knew some of them might choose to be captured rather than end their own lives.
There was a deep bitterness in Constance's tone that Kristen needed to understand.
But if both parties agree to this contract, she began, how is it something they're forced to do?
The woman chuckled darkly.
Oh, sweet Kristen Hall, I wish all dragons were as trusting and naive as you are. Sadly, mutual agreement is not the history of contractual magic.
Can we cut the mystic crap and tell me how the hell it works? She snapped.
Larry shrugged and forced a weak grin.
Unfortunately, she's right. It's been used in ages past by dragon lords on their dragon vassals, by human mages to control other humans, and by dragons to control captured mages, among other things. But how could it be bad if both parties agreed? Keith asked.
It's good to see it's not only the leader that's naive, Constance sneered. Obviously, many people will agree to all kinds of things if the alternative is being eaten by a dragon.
Or being ripped apart by a mage,
Stonequest added.
They're not wrong, Larry concurred. It has a particularly nasty history since this type of magic has been abused many times in the past. It fell out of style when the magic dampening cuffs were invented. For most situations, those have served the dragons fine. But, well, Windlock and I discussed all this once or twice. I would have agreed to it to be free of my bracelet, but we decided it might ruffle too many scales, so to speak.
You know how to do it?
Constance asked, obviously incredulous.
I do, he said simply, and for once used less words than he might have needed instead of more.
How does it work? Kristen asked.
Well, the basis of it is a paper contract. You write out the terms, read it out exactly as written, and sign in blood. Once you do that, you cannot break the vows you make or... Well, like Constance said...
He mimed an explosion with his hands. The gesture made her suddenly nostalgic for when she first met him, when her world had barely begun to get as complicated as it currently was. Kristen wasn't sure what to do. She could definitely understand Constance's objections. It wouldn't do for her to bring the mages out one by one and force them to agree to fight for her or be devoured. And it could be used for far worse than that. Now that she knew it could be agreed to under duress, she understood how horribly it could be, and probably had been, used. But it could also be used for good, couldn't it? What if everyone who signs is not under duress? She asked. What if everyone agrees to it willingly?
There are precedents for that, Larry was quick to point out. When the United States tried to end its slave trade, a few dragons sided with the abolitionists. They convinced landowners to set their slaves free by agreeing to one of these contracts. The slaver, future former slavers, agreed to it because the dragons signed as well. It meant that if a dragon took a slave, they'd be killed by the spell. Back in those days, it was impossible to even think of.
Those cases are the exceptions, not the rule, Constance spat.
But what if Kristen wrote it?
Larry asked, grinning like a fool.
If the contract were written in a way that forced her to be a proper liege and leader, it might make it more palatable to your mages. Hell, I know you might not believe it, but if we could write one of these in terms we all liked, I'd be happy to sign it. I trust her with my life as it is. I'd put it in writing.
I don't know. Kristen wasn't fond of the idea. It reeks of mind control. Too many people would lose their free will.
No, they wouldn't, he was quick to say. Dragons have far more formidable mind control powers with their auras.
Heartsbane, who had the most powerful aura of anyone Kristen had ever worked with, scoffed, but she didn't deny what he said either.
I've thought about this often over the years. I think that, if done right, it's the way forward. It is more powerful and could be abused. But Kristen, you're the steel dragon. You won't abuse it because we won't force anyone to sign. This could be a real move toward equality. A document to prove that everyone on this planet can work together.
Work together or die, you mean? Constance said.
Well, sure, yeah. But we didn't exactly suffer zero casualties capturing this base. And I know some of your mages died too. This way will be better if everyone agrees to it.
I wouldn't know where to begin to write a contract that we could all agree to, Kristen said, and fixed him with a pointed stare.
Let me see what I can do, Larry said. Like I said, I've thought about this for much longer than only the last few minutes.
Fine, she said, and he vanished into the tunnels of the complex to locate paper, pens, and possibly something to prick all their fingers.
Is this how you always work? The Technomage leader asked. Letting whoever on your team do as they wish?
I don't have a problem with democracy, she retorted. But I'll read this as carefully as your mages will.
So you will offer it to them?
Constance asked. She seemed both surprised and interested.
You're right that we could use the additional help if war is about to break out. If there is any way to get your people's help in a way I can be sure I can trust them, I think it's worth a try.
Even if it means your death, if you fail to uphold your end of the contract?
I've risked my life every day since I became a cop, so might as well get that shit in writing.
The woman chuckled and rolled her eyes.
We'll start working on the portal spell. It will take a little practice for us all to do it efficiently. I look forward to reading this contract.
Chapter 5 Larry managed to produce a document that was surprisingly impressive. Kristen read the parts that pertained to her first. The leash was the language of the contract, with particular interest. She was not to ask the signees to do anything that violated their ethics. It didn't mean that if she gave them an order they didn't like, she would explode, only that if something felt wrong to them, they could protest. She wasn't concerned about this. These people had done horrible things to dragons, killed humans, and who knew what else. That clause basically meant she couldn't kill them indiscriminately or hurt their families. That was fine with her. She also had to treat their lives as if they were as valuable as her own and honor a commitment to keep them as safe as possible during a time of war. The contract would expire when the risk of war between humans and dragons was over, or when the war itself ended, whichever happened first. That was to be agreed to by Kristen, and at least half of whoever signed it. In return for these assurances, the signees were to swear to follow her orders in the spirit in which they were issued. More specifically, They were to dedicate themselves to preventing as many deaths of both dragons and humans as possible. They were to do all they could to prevent war between humanity and dragonkind, and if war did break out, they were to work to end it with as few lives lost on both sides as possible. It seemed reasonable to her, and also like a good way to find out if any of the mages there were actively working for the Masked One. There was no way a mole would sign something like this. Not that it meant anyone who didn't sign was working with the Masked One. Surely qualms could be had with the verbose document. It only meant that those who did sign truly could be trusted. Larry finally managed to achieve the correct wording on his third attempt. Once Kristen liked what it said, and Constance grumbled only minimally, the dragons and human fighters were instructed to unlock the cells and bring all the mages out onto the beach. Part of her wanted to use the hollowed-out heart of a volcano the mages had used for the center of their operation, but she thought the beach was ultimately more fitting. It was a place of freedom and open horizons, where you could practically see into tomorrow. She hoped the mages saw it that way, too. It took a while for everyone to gather. Kristen stood with her people, the dragons, mages, and humans who had fought alongside her. Across from them, a line of technomages waited with their leaders, Constance, Eric, Havington, and the Iron Dragon Katrina in front. Everyone watched and listened as she read the document, and the blue sky gave way to the rich colors of a tropical sunset. When she finished, she pricked her finger with the quill of a bird. This was apparently essential to the spell and had cost Emerald an hour of time spent hunting a pelican merely to snatch a tail feather. And she signed. She immediately felt some of her energy flow into the paper. It had come from a ream with perforated edges that had been used by printers that were practically obsolete even when she was a kid. Her blood seemed to course through the document to make the words Larry had written seem to burn into the paper. She also found that the somewhat fragile paper seemed to strengthen with it. Larry stepped forward to sign next, a grin on his face as he read through the half of the document that pertained to him and all the other signees. Stonequest and Drew were already fighting to be the second signee, and the rest of her friends, human and dragon, were in line behind them. They chuckled and pulled faces at each other as they prepared to prick their fingers. Suddenly, Drew and Stonequest were lifted off their feet and moved a few feet back before Amy landed beside Kristen. "You saved my life. I always intended to serve you, but like you said, we might as well make it official." The girl signed, and Drew and Stonequest followed. Jim wanted to sign next, but those remaining wouldn't let him, so they ended up reading it as a group. Kristen couldn't help but shed a few tears of pride as her friends fought to agree to help her with their very lives. They had all suffered so much for her. Each one of them had spent tears, sweat, blood, and hours of their lives. And still, they wanted to give more. It was too much, more than she deserved and more than anyone deserved. She was honored by them and was almost glad to have something to bind her to them. A reminder that their lives were worth as much, if not more, than her own. Finally, they had all signed, except Hernandez.
"You know I might try to make you break this shit simply to watch you blow up, right?"
the woman said.
"Anything to make you finally shut up."
Kristen laughed and wiped tears from her eyes.
"You can't tell me to do that. It's against my ethics to stop talking shit."
Hernandez smiled as she signed and the blood from her signature coursed through the paper and strengthened it further. Now that her people had signed, Kristen turned to the assembled prisoners.
"I want to offer all of you a chance to redeem yourselves. Let's not pretend your actions in the past didn't hurt people. But you'd been fooled, tricked, and betrayed. Each one of you endeavored to end the machinations of dragons intent on controlling human lives. But Constance has made it clear to me that, in fact, your movement was co-opted by one of the very dragons you sought to destroy. The Masked One has used all of you to stir up a war that neither side will win, simply so he can become more powerful. Everything he has had you do, all the dragon bullets and all the killing, was to hurt humanity, not save it. It was all to give that dragon an excuse to steal more power. The way to peace is not through violence, but through peace. Join me!"
Her words drew grumbles and whispers from the prisoners. Looks were cast from one to another, while heads shook in subtle disagreements, and some jaws hardened. No one looked exactly eager to swear themselves to the dragon they'd worked so hard to destroy for so long. Kristen had hoped for better, but she couldn't exactly blame them. It couldn't be easy to have a longtime enemy tell you that you had a choice to join her side. And, oh yeah, you've been tricked for ages, and your mission is phony, and you're not even smart enough to realize you've been had. Still, she'd hoped for at least a few defectors to join sides with her. She really did believe in the terms Larry had written. Maybe she was simply optimistic, but she had thought the mages might believe too.
"I know how it sounds," Constance said.
She stepped forward and away from the technomage leaders before she turned to face the others with her back to Kristen.
"I know it's hard to think we've worked to fulfill someone else's dream, but we've all known that dragons are capable of this kind of deception. How many of you know a mage who wished to join our fight but couldn't because a dragon had already thrown a shackle on their wrist and denied them their power?"
A fresh round of mutters and grumbles followed this. Kristen had never thought of that aspect of their organization, that these mages might be fighting for more than merely the idea of equality, and might be fighting for people they knew who had done nothing wrong besides having the same powers they had. Powers that, if they were dragons, would have been celebrated, but because they were human mages, were nothing but liabilities.
"We all have," Constance went on. "Every one of us knows of the persuasive powers of dragons. I'll be the first to admit they tricked me. I thought I was in control, but the steel dragon is right. All our agitating, all these bullets, and all the dragons we have killed haven't made the world more peaceful, but less so. Humankind is closer to being attacked by the dragons than ever. And it's our fault."
"That doesn't make dragons innocent," Havington hissed. "One lizard tricking us doesn't mean we should sign up with another one."
Kristen made a note of this. Perhaps it was he who often contacted the Masked One. Although she had begun to think that if any of the mages had regular contact with their mysterious puppet master, they probably didn't even realize it.
"I'll join forces with Kristen Hall, not because she's the Steel Dragon, but because she's still Kristen Hall. She's telling the truth about the Masked One, exactly like I thought she would when I told her about his existence."
Gasps indicated that none of the technomages had any prior knowledge of the mysterious dragon, and that their leader had not only known, but had kept the information from them.
"I know," she said to the tight-jawed, frowning mages. "I should have told you, but I didn't. I thought we would be safer if this information wasn't spread. That's the kind of leader I was, and that's why I failed you. I'll sign this document because Kristen doesn't lie to her people. She's open and honest and has always fought for the same thing we have. I'll sign to help undo the damage we have done and save as many people as possible before it's too late. That is, if you'll have me," Constance said, and directed the last to Kristen.
"If you'll agree to the terms of this contract, I would proudly have you at my side," she said.
"That's better than I deserve."
The woman's head was held high with pride, despite her words saying she didn't deserve it. She read the contract aloud, her voice strong and full of emotion, shed a tear when she pricked her finger, and signed. The contract sparkled when she wrote her name. The contract somehow knew she was a powerful mage.
"Once again, I offer all of you a chance at redemption," Kristen said. "There's no shame in acting as you did if you didn't know everything. But now that you do, it has to stop. You can still be heroes if you'll only help us to stop the Masked One and the war he's pushed us all toward."
"I don't see why we should trust you lizards," Havington said.
She had no doubt his fists would be wreathed in flame if only he had the power to do so.
"Dragons are the problem. This Masked One is a problem. The dragons we've killed were problems. You're a problem. I have no faith that beings who held onto their power for 10,000 years will relinquish it simply because we stop one of their more cretinous members."
"Then don't sign," she said simply. "If you truly believe I'm evil, don't sign. If you think I have caused more damage to humanity than the forces and attitudes I have fought against since the day I learned I was a dragon, then by all means, try to break your restraints and fight us. I won't let you go to kill me, exactly like none of you released the dragons you held in captivity. I won't begrudge you this choice if you make it, but this contract is your path to freedom and equality.
The terms are fair, Constance said. I hope you join me. But if not, a yacht is on its way. It should be here in a week, and you'll be able to cruise home in luxury with the dragons we imprisoned for so long. I know even looking them in the eyes would be too much for me. But if that's what you wish, so be it.
It felt like forever before the first mage broke ranks. But once she did, more than half of the others followed. To Kristen's surprise, the other Technomage cell leader, Eric, was willing to sign, and even led a group in chorus to recite the contract together as her team had done. The only notable mage who refused was Havington. He scowled and said he was concerned that if he looked at Kristen the wrong way after signing, he'd explode. She didn't press him. While she thought he was a fool, she didn't want to turn this contract into something that bound people against their will. It would be nothing more than another weapon. The world had enough of those. There was one more notable encounter, though. The Iron Dragon walked up with a scowl. Without her iron skin, Kristen could tell how closely they resembled each other. They had the same red curly hair, although Katrina's was slightly darker, the same freckles and the same figure. She even thought they had the same shoe size.
It's hard to look you in the face, the woman said to her.
I thought the same thing, she responded.
It's tough because you're a reminder of how weak I would be if I hadn't been raised by Constance. I don't like being reminded of that.
It must be even worse to have those cuffs on then, given how I put them on you after I kicked your ass. Katrina smirked.
Only because we couldn't use our dragon forms.
She offered a mirrored facetious smirk. It was the exact expression she wore when she was trying to one-up someone.
Maybe, she said. Are you going to sign or what?
Katrina looked surprised at that.
Wait, you're okay with me signing this? You'd fight with me? Even after all our battles?
Kristen shrugged. I won't ask you to be my roommate or anything, and God knows I wouldn't take you out for beers anytime soon. But if you can agree to this contract, I'd be glad to have you on our side. You're a strong fighter.
You got that right, the woman snapped.
There's no weakness in admitting you're strong, she continued. I've seen you fight. I know what you can do. Plus, I'd like to learn more about you. Together, we might be able to unlock even more of our powers.
If this is some kind of trick,
you can read the contract again if you like, she said. But if you think I'm smart enough to trick Constance and your leader, Eric, how can you hope to stand against me? The Iron Dragon snorted at that, although she looked at the two mage leaders with wide eyes. Kristen saw the same bare trust in Katrina's eyes for the two mages she had as her parents.
How hard that must be, she thought, for your parents to also be your boss and for your job to be a terrorist.
She had no doubt that Katrina's life had been far more difficult than her own. Although they seemed to share much of their DNA, they did not share experiences, and they would likely never see eye to eye. She hoped that would be enough for her sibling.
I still don't trust you,
Katrina said finally, after she'd stared at the contract for what felt like forever.
But I trust them. If you'll have me, I'll sign.
Are you sure? She asked.
My word is as strong as iron, she said with a cheeky smile.
That's impressive.
It's almost as strong as steel,
Kristen replied, unable to help herself. Katrina snorted again, but she read the contract aloud, pricked her finger, obviously shocked that a simple knife could hurt her at all because of the cuffs, and signed it as well. The mages who refused to sign were escorted to their cells. Kristen looked at the people who'd accepted this bond with her as their liege.
I guess it's time to take those bracelets off.
Despite them not wearing them for very long, when they came off, it was evident that the mages had wilted under the stifling effects of the magic dampening cuffs. Immediately, they perked up and flexed their magic powers by making dervishes of sand or shapes in the waves. She was pleased to see that none of them tried to test the contract by attacking any of her allies. It seemed a piece had been found. At least for now. All right, the first order of business, she said and clapped sharply, like all this was perfectly fine and completely normal. It's time to open that portal. Chapter 6.
Where to? Constance asked.
It was a fair question, and one that Kristen didn't have an answer to. We need to operate under the assumptions that the Masked One is on the Dragon Council, and that he'll try to push for war as soon as possible, she said.
So we should find the Council and tell them not to listen to whoever the hell is pushing for war,
Keith said, as if it were so obvious.
The problem is the Council doesn't exactly post their whereabouts, Stonequest explained. Even when the world isn't on the precipice of a dragon-human war that could exterminate one or both life forms, they're extremely secretive. Do we assume the Masked One is on the North American Council?
We do, Constance confirmed.
Then we can essentially narrow it down to the entire continent of North America,
he finished.
That doesn't exactly help, Hernandez complained.
We will prepare the portal, Constance said with a nod, and excused herself.
Tell us as soon as you have a destination. What about someplace like Kansas? Jim asked. That's the middle of the continent, give or take. If we go there, we'd be a few hours away from shit hitting the fan instead of days.
I don't like that, Kristen said. Hours is more than enough time to raise a city. We need a better plan.
I think we should go to Detroit, Stonequest said. Amethyst said the SWAT forces have left, and since we know the Dragon SWAT forces in Detroit, we can probably determine where they've gone to.
Where do you think they've gone to?
Beanpole, normally so quiet, asked.
If I was the Masked One, and I'm not, Heartsbane said, I would try to mass all the fighting dragons. If he can build a force and convince them to fight together, it wouldn't matter where they're located. If he can make the SWAT teams a cohesive unit, that would be a force more than strong enough to wipe humanity out.
The massive satellite phone in Kristen's hand rang, and she answered immediately. It was Brian.
This had better be urgent, she said sharply.
It is,
he said so loudly it caused the old device to feedback.
We have all kinds of activity in Detroit, and not good activity. Dragons have arrived and they're attacking the city. They've already torched Tiger Stadium, and it looks like they're moving to the rest of downtown.
Brian, this is important, she said. Are they flying in formation? Can you tell?
No, I don't think so. Does anyone have a phone there? I can send video.
Keith dug one out of his pocket.
Am I the only guy with a waterproof case? Seriously? What do the rest of you do at water parks?
This is not the time, Keith.
Kristen snatched the phone from his hand. Brian had already patched a video feed through to it. Dragons swooped and attacked her city that had been attacked by the damn mages only a week before. If this wasn't the work of the same architect, she would eat her tail.
Stonequest, she said. Do you know any of them? Are they Dragon SWAT?
The dragon watched the screen carefully, far too carefully for her as he took forever, but he finally shook his head.
No, those aren't on any SWAT team I've ever met. In fact,
he paused as one swooped low and torched the camera that was recording them. Brian immediately switched to another. His sister guessed that he'd commandeered the city's traffic cameras.
I've busted that one before. Unauthorized duel. He's a lowlife named Cole or Char, something like that. I've sent that asshole to prison twice.
So it could merely be lowlifes causing trouble, Heartsbane said. When the cat is away, the mice will play and all that.
It's possible, Stonequest said.
I don't care why they're attacking, only how we'll stop their asses, Kristen said,
and scowled when she recognized a dragon as well. It was one of those who had tried to beat her up in prison and who had worked for Obscura.
I guess Stonequest was right. We need to get to Detroit. Time Flash, you'll have to come with us as I think we'll need your abilities. Two of the younger dragons can stay with Larry.
On it,
Keith shouted and ran down the beach to tell Constance, Larry, and the mages who were working on the portal. She looked at her assembled team. Although battle-weary from fighting the mages, not one of them looked like they weren't ready for this fight.
What are our orders? Stonequest asked.
We'll believe what Constance said about this being most of the technomages, she said, with no better reason to do so other than what her gut told her. It means I want dragons going through this portal as dragons.
Once you're in Detroit, take to the air and try to give the rest of us a few minutes to get through and get clear. From what I saw of Zed's footage, the city's already in trouble, so every second counts.
What are we waiting for?
Hernandez asked as she clipped grenades to her belt. Kristen smiled.
I'm waiting for you all to grab your guns and get to that portal. The last one through has to stay here with Larry and listen to his jokes.
A few chuckles followed, but mostly people simply retrieved their gear. The dragons transformed and flew down to the beach where a ring of light was already forming in the red light of the sunset. Kristen wanted to fight, but she knew she had to stick with her people to issue orders when they first went through. A little frustrated, she watched as the mages snapped the portal open, and there on the beach was Grand River Avenue. The first thing she noticed about the city was how bright it was. Obviously, if it was sunset in the Pacific, it was a different time of day in the Motor City. The next thing she noticed were the flames. They were everywhere. Already, half the windows in the Michigan building poured smoke, and the bottom floor seemed to be totally consumed by fires. Her blood boiled as her city burned. Any plans to watch as her dragons rushed through went up in flames.
Come on, we fight today with new allies, but that doesn't mean we fight any less hard. Now, what are we waiting for? Charge!
She transformed into her steel dragon body and led her forces through the portal. Chapter 7. The enemy dragons did not fail to recognize the magical gateway as a threat. As soon as Kristen came through it into downtown Detroit, she felt the heat of dragon flames on her back. But she was the steel dragon. It would take more than a glancing jet of fire to harm her metal scales. The heat did compromise her aerodynamics, though. So rather than soaring through and above the skyline of Detroit, she was forced to land. The enemy dragons were poised to take advantage of this turn of events. One of them drove into her back, and she grimaced against the now familiar pain of dragon talons cutting through her steel scales to pierce her flesh. The wound wasn't deep, fortunately. Her scales could be sliced by dragon talons, but they blunted most of the damage. She still had sufficient strength and presence of mind to whip the dragon off her back with an axe blade on the tip of her tail. The force when her steel-covered tail pounded into her attacker was enough to launch him violently through the bottom floor of the Michigan building. He leapt out, grinning and silhouetted by flames. He was a runty little creature, and perhaps a little bigger than half of Kristen's size. Something about his face triggered her memories.
"Didn't I kick your ass in prison?" she asked.
The dragon roared at her, thus proving that yes, she had indeed kicked his ass, and he tried to scramble past her and get to the portal she'd come from. His foolish defiance had cost him precious seconds, however. Already, the other SWAT dragons were coming through. Stonequest knocked the attacker aside with a swipe of his claw and catapulted him into a car that he crushed with the force of his impact. Although he was somewhat diminutive compared to his fellows, he was still more than big enough to deliver that kind of damage. It was a reminder to Kristen that the fight would not be an easy one. Her forces had to protect the city and defeat the dragons. The attackers only had to burn them all.
Stonequest, cover that portal, she ordered.
He led Heartsbane, Emerald, Lumos, and Timeflash into a tight circle above the portal. The other less experienced dragons emerged next.
Choose a target and stick to them. I want dragon on dragon to keep them focused on you and not the city, she ordered.
Despite the strange request, strange to them anyway, as they were not used to protecting anything but themselves, the dragons obeyed. Each of them targeted one of the marauders and surged with claw and tail as they released blasts of fire that did little except annoy their opponents.
Stonequest, they need support!
He nodded and broke away from his other SWAT team members. It was great to have more dragons on their team, but none of the new recruits had much combat experience. Their lack meant they wouldn't be able to do much besides distract their opponents for long. And much needed to be done. All over, the city was on fire. Police and firefighters raced frantically to rescue people who were trapped in buildings, cars, or simply frozen in fear. Every human had always known this could happen. Living in a world with dragons meant you lived on their whims. It was a constant reminder that you were mortal. But still, it didn't exactly prepare anyone for six dragons to simply rain fire on a city like it was the end of times.
Holy shit! Drew shouted as he led the human forces through the portal. What exactly are we supposed to do about this?
Kristen was terrified that the question was way too big, but she also knew that, as a leader, she had to answer it.
You know some of the cops here. Call your old captain and tell her you're here to help to get people to safety. We'll handle the dragons. I want you to get as many people as you can out of here.
He looked at the smoke-choked, fire-filled sky.
Yes, ma'am,
he said, without batting an eyelid. As more and more humans came through, Drew issued orders. He'd put everyone in squads long before, and now sent those groups to help evacuate buildings and clear escape paths. Any of the enemy dragons who tried to veer away from the battle were met with a storm of bullets. Kristen hadn't ordered her team to equip with dragon bullets. She probably should have, but she was too concerned about friendly fire problems. Still, the enemy were far more wary of the guns than they would have been a year before. They hesitated when they approached the human forces, which of course gave her dragons time to catch them. Stonequest, in particular, was able to seize the opportunity created by one of these hesitations. He powered into the back of a dragon who looked like his skin was made of gravel and held him tightly as the two spun above the city. His adversary couldn't escape, but he wasn't about to give in without a fight either. He slashed at his attacker's chest and drew blood. Stonequest didn't flinch. Instead, he kept his dive carefully controlled so they avoided any buildings. Then, at the last moment, he transformed his entire body into marble and landed on top of his opponent. The force drove the dragon into the street below him, created a massive crater, and left the raider utterly motionless. Whether dead or unconscious, Kristen didn't know, and Stonequest didn't seem to care. With one threat neutralized, he launched once again to give chase to another target. Kristen turned to the portal as the mages, many of them former enemies, came through. Finally, Constance, Katrina, and Eric entered Detroit. Larry waved from the other side as if he were disembarking for a vacation instead of being left in charge of a group of prisoners. The gate closed a moment later, and he was gone.
Mages, I need you to put out as many of these flames as possible!
You heard the dragon!
Constance said, and led her forces away to attack the fires. Only one didn't follow the order. A man with a mustache who had only begrudgingly signed the contract.
This is what we were fighting to stop!
He screamed. Electricity crackled from his temples, down his arms, and wound around his knuckles in the shape of barbed wire.
Dragons kill people, and we're supposed to serve you? This is fucking crazy! Crazy, I tell you!
Rather than following Constance, he turned on Kristen, no doubt confident that his electrical powers could get through her steel skin. He managed only about 5 steps toward her before he exploded. 1 second, he was a man crackling with power, and in the next, he was nothing but a sooty stain on the street.
Nice job, Steel,
Katrina sneered at her, still in her human body.
The first of our mages to die, and it was because of your contract.
Do you want to be next? You promised you wouldn't try to kill me. Do you want to see what happens if you do? She asked.
Katrina made no response and apparently honored her word far better than the dead mage had. In her moment of hesitation, Kristen took one last opportunity to assess the battle before she decided where she would enter the fight. The mages were making real progress against the fires. Constance used her power over the winds to smother the flames. Rather than blow wind at the fires, she could use it to keep fresh air away from the flames. This turned raging infernos into smoldering embers that firefighters were then able to extinguish with their hoses. Eric also seemed to have a favorite kind of magic and used it to extinguish fires. When they'd fought him, he'd thrown 1,000 tiny needles at them. He used a similar technique now to rip flaming boards apart and send the embers high into the sky so they burned away as nothing but fireworks washed out in the early morning sun. Other, less powerful mages worked together to extinguish burning buildings. Those with augmented strength asked firefighters what walls could be punched through to give their hoses better access to the flames. Those with elemental abilities either doused flames or tried to contain them. It looked like the city would survive if the dragons overhead weren't allowed to do anything else to it.
Dragon SWAT!
Kristen roared.
Yes, ma'am,
they replied from wherever they were in the chaos.
Are you ready to take out the trash?
They all bellowed an affirmative, except Heartsbane, who shouted,
I thought you'd never ask.
What about you? Kristen asked Katrina, and watched her reaction carefully.
She was still far from trusting the Iron Dragon fully. The spell was in place, so she knew she couldn't attack her directly. But she didn't seem as ready to fight with her as Constance was. She still felt like she needed to get to know her sister better before she could offer her real trust. Thankfully, it seemed that Katrina was more than willing to prove her reliability this time around.
"I've spent my entire life protecting humans against dragons who have overstepped their bounds," she growled, looked at the sky, and assumed her dragon shape. "I'm more than happy to stop a few more."
The two took to the air together. As they gained height, Kristen watched the former members of Dragon SWAT bring the fight to the rogue dragons. It was an amazing sight. Before, it had been like watching gulls fight each other. Her new recruits could fight well enough, but so could the rogues. Neither had been able to gain much traction or advantage over the other side. Now, it was more like watching peregrine falcons hunt pigeons. The members of Dragon SWAT had been trained for years to fight against dragons, and better yet, they knew the tactics of some of those they now fought. Heartsbane closed in on a long, sinuous dragon who turned in midair and tried to spray her with some kind of viscous sludge. The SWAT dragon clearly had experience with the expectorant, as she closed her wings around her face so they were coated in the gunk rather than her face. She landed to clean the crap from her wings, annoyed but not hurt.
"When you said trash, I didn't think you meant literal slime," she groused.
Kristen didn't mind that she was temporarily grounded. It gave her an opportunity to attack a target with Katrina at her side.
"The slimy one is ours," she ordered.
The Iron Dragon nodded. Together, they pumped their wings between skyscrapers and gained altitude until they were above them. Although they'd never worked together before, there was instant grace to the way the two dragons flew as a unit. Both could turn their bodies to metal, but knew not to unless they needed to defend themselves, or until they were above another dragon and could use the additional weight to aid in a dive assault. This meant they moved the same way, tried to gain altitude, and turned their metal skin on and off intermittently to block blasts from the other dragons that battled all around them.
"You use your skin well!"
Kristen shouted at Katrina as they drew closer to the slime dragon.
"You too! I can almost forget that you have hardly any experience with it. You need to guard your back legs better, by the way. That hip joint can be brutalized if you let it..."
"My back?" Kristen asked, and felt the teeth of another dragon sink into her thigh. It seemed the rogue dragons weren't particularly keen on fighting the law enforcement dragons that some of them had faced and failed against multiple times. Not when there was a dragon present who many had a personal grudge against.
"You coward! You're the piece of shit who tried to shiv me!"
she yelled at the dragon, clinging desperately to her leg with its teeth.
"Woof woof woo!"
he snarled in return, his mouth full of her flesh that rendered the words unintelligible. Still, it didn't take a linguist to realize that he had used that simplest of all human curses against her. The F-bomb. She couldn't shake him, though. The bastard had sunk his teeth deep in her leg, and her efforts to dislodge him proved futile. The Iron Dragon plummeted and pounded into his back. The air was knocked from his lungs, and he fell, Katrina on top of him, until she crushed him into the pavement below, her iron body multiplying the force of the blow to lethal levels. Oh, Kristen was thankful. It was always good to have someone stop a dragon from ripping your leg off. But she also realized that it meant Katrina would be out of this for the next couple of minutes. It took time for a metal dragon to gain height, and while she did so, she and the four dragons harrying her were already high above the city. They attacked with about as much grace as they had in prison. She couldn't be sure if these were the same ones who had attacked her with makeshift prison weapons when she had been falsely accused and incarcerated without her powers. But she decided she'd go ahead and fight them like they were.
"Metal pipe!"
she yelled, as if greeting an old friend when a gray-scaled dragon with black, broken-looking teeth led the charge. She called on the training Lumos had given her, struck out with her tail, and swung it into the joint connecting his wing to his body. Her adversary shrieked in pain when the axe-blade tail connected, then plunged like a bird with a wing broken by a jet plane. Emerald dove after him and sank his claws into the dragon's back. His talons caused pain, but also spared his life when he guided him to the top of a building and forced him to transform. Three more remained, and none seemed inclined to retreat.
"I'm sorry, it's been such a long time. How did I kick your ass?"
Kristen asked a red dragon, who left trails of smoke from his wings in his wake.
I almost choked you to death with a chain, bitch!
He directed great plumes of smoke at her. It didn't hurt, but it left her blind in a cloud of gas that made it hard to breathe, and therefore do all the other things breathing made possible.
Now you'll choke for real!
Kristen would have felt bad about her dragon SWAT teammates attacking him, if not for two reasons. The first was that the dragon engaged her with as much help as he could get, so why should she do differently? The second was the horrible pun. Because of these two reasons, she didn't feel bad when she heard a shriek from her formerly smug adversary. She pumped her wings and finally moved clear of the smoke cloud. Lumos had torn a huge hole in the dragon's wing, captured him with his claws, and now guided him to the top of another building. The last two dragons didn't seem so keen on a reunion. With a glance and a pulse of their aura at each other, their intentions became clear. They wanted to get the fuck out of there. Unfortunately for them, they decided to do that together. Kristen, Stonequest, Heartsbane, and Timeflash were able to pursue them without having to go in separate directions. It didn't take long to catch up with the first. He must have been injured at some point, as one of his wings flapped more sluggishly than the other to slow him sufficiently for them to overtake him easily. Stonequest took hold of him and said something in the dragon's ear that must have been quite persuasive, because he stopped trying to flee and attempted to glide as he was led to the top of another building. That left only one dragon. Despite the odds stacked against this one, he continued the attempt to flee and pumped his wings furiously to increase his speed. Amazingly, it began to outpace Kristen and her team. Maybe his power was quickness, or his slighter frame simply allowed him to move faster. Whatever the cause, she thought for a moment that he would elude them, and she muttered in frustration. Moments later, the dragon appeared to simply make impact with an invisible wall. To her, it looked like something out of a cartoon, like someone had painted a fake sky and the dragon had thought it was open space, when in fact it was a decoy colored with acme paint. To the dragons, she discovered later, it was far more obvious what had happened. A mage had stepped in. Kristen saw it too when she thought more clearly. The air had a blue shimmer, the same color of the shields Amy and Larry used to block bullets. The dragon had powered into this barrier, and Timeflash grasped him in her talons as he began to fall. The battle was over. The steel dragon coasted earthward and was met by Amy. This was only a little odd because the girl met her 100 feet off the ground. She rode her skateboard, which was weirder than if she had been flying. A quirk of the young mage's enormous power was that she couldn't lift herself. She had to stand on other objects or use her clothing.
I'm sorry it took so long,
the girl smirked, fully aware that she had stopped a dragon in its tracks without breaking a sweat.
Constance wasn't kidding about that portal sapping my strength. It took me a full minute to build enough power to stop that asshole.
Kristen soared past the mage and marveled at her power.
Come on, we have a city to put back together.
Chapter 8. The chaos of the battle was over, and Kristen issued orders to restore the city where they could. The mages had already proven useful in battle, but truly seeing them help mend things in the aftermath was an even more inspiring reason for them to be on the side of a peaceful humanity. Those with telekinetic powers used them to patch brick, stack damaged cars, and move rubble so construction crews would be able to get to work immediately. Timeflash moved among them in her human form, giving tips to some and asking for help from others. Her power was unique in the dragon world, as she could put objects back together in their original condition. She focused on the Michigan building, and Kristen watched in delight as windows mended themselves and smoke billowed into the building to reconstitute itself into chairs, paintings, and furniture. None of the mages had this skill, but they could augment Timeflash's abilities, and those who helped her looked about as thrilled as Kristen did. It was pure magic to see something completely destroyed returned to its former glory. Unfortunately, the dragon's powers were anything but limitless. After fixing the Michigan building, she was almost spent. She helped get a fire station in working order, although she was unable to remove any of the soot stains there, and could do no more. Still, between her abilities and the power of the mages, the city returned to something resembling normalcy. Windows still had to be mended, and many insurance claims would be filed for wrecked cars, but at least the streets were navigable. Kristen left the cleanup crew to check on their four prisoners. The two dragons who had been pounded into the ground hadn't survived the impact, but the other four had been taken into custody. They now all wore bracelets that, only hours ago, had been worn by mages who had tried to kill dragons. Despite the turn of events, none of the four seemed particularly thankful to be captured by mages instead of killed. They all stood sullenly on the roof of Dragon SWAT headquarters in the old Capitol Square building in downtown Detroit. Kristen landed and looked fondly at the rooftop. She couldn't count the number of missions that had begun there, nor how many times she'd been reprimanded by Stonequest when he'd been her boss, rather than the other way around. Stonequest, is there a reason why we haven't started processing these dragons? I seem to remember some fairly uncomfortable cells they might all find familiar.
Actually?
He looked alarmed.
There is.
The stone dragon gestured toward the rooftop entrance to the building, where Atramento stood. The mage looked more exhausted than she had ever seen him. He was master of the paper dungeon, the bureaucratic center for Detroit's Dragon SWAT team, and managed much of the paperwork of the Midwest as well. Kristen couldn't imagine what could have compelled him to leave the station he had always seemed almost obsessed with, especially with the mountain of paperwork that would be needed. They had to process these four dragons, as well as the two dead ones, and all the damage they'd caused to the city.
Atramento? She asked. Is everything all right?
He looked at her, his robes a little limp, and the tattoos on his head, face, and hands still made him look otherworldly, despite the expression of defeat on his face.
They said they let me stay because of my service, he said weakly. Like it was a reward to be left in the wreckage.
Wreckage? She asked.
It wasn't like him to talk about his well-oiled filing cabinet of a floor as anything but perfection.
That's all they left. They destroyed any records that had to do with dragon imprisonment. Already, requests have begun to come in for dragons who have been falsely imprisoned without paperwork. It's disgusting.
The mage shook his head as if there were no affront worse to society than that of false bureaucratic claims.
Even those I would process. There's a procedure, of course, for missing documents, even if they were burned. But I can't even do that.
Why not?
She asked, although she feared she already knew the answer. Atramento choked out a sob as he raised his wrist. On it, he wore a heavy cuff.
They put this on me. After all I've done, they put this on me.
He uttered another sob and did not seem to be doing well at all. She didn't think he'd even noticed that the city had been attacked.
What is it?
Amy asked and glowered at the cuff in distaste.
It's a cuff like they use for prisoners. It blocks my magic. All my magic. They came here and ordered every mage to put one on, the brutes. We were already fitted with cuffs that wouldn't let us move against them. They didn't need to do this.
Who? Kristen asked.
Dragons,
Atramento told her sharply, his tone venomous.
Where is everyone else? Kristen asked.
They took them all away. I asked where so I could update forwarding addresses, but they wouldn't tell me. Do you know what a nightmare this is? Even with my powers, this would have been difficult to fix, but without them, I fear I may be held accountable for a dereliction of duties.
He looked more concerned about this black mark on his record than the dragons were at the prospect of being imprisoned. Maybe they knew something she didn't.
But why take the mages? They can't hurt dragons. That's the whole point of the cuffs, she said. Do they think they can be used as weapons against people?
Stonequest shook his head.
I doubt that. It's probably the opposite. They are rounding up every known mage because dragons don't trust them, not because they do. They'll keep the mages out of the way so they can't decide to switch sides and fight with the humans during the culling.
The word calling made her blood run cold. She knew Stonequest had only said it because he'd heard it used in this context before. He'd endeavored to keep the dragon bullet's secrets because he feared this exact outcome. Part of her wished he'd been successful, although the wiser part of her knew the mages had to be stopped, and that they were on the only path they could be on.
But mages can't hurt dragons, Kristen said.
He shrugged.
That used to be the case, but the technomages have proven that some can escape detection. No doubt the other dragons think this means the mages could escape. They must be holding them somewhere to keep them out of the action.
That was a sobering thought. What kind of holding place were all those mages in? If they were detained, was it humanely? Or had the dragons thrown them in a cell and simply planned to do away with them as well? She was certain of one thing. This was bigger than the six dragons who had openly attacked the city. While she had expected it to be, she had held out hope that they were simply dragons acting out because SWAT was gone.
Do you think they're being treated well? Kristen asked.
Stonequest's expression said very eloquently that he thought this very unlikely.
There's always been talk in the Dragon Council, and demands that all the mages be exterminated. They've led two rebellions before this, after all, and were damn close to winning them even without dragon bullets. Now, with the bullets, plus Amy's insane power, I'm sure they're taking the threat of mages even more seriously.
But this is crazy! We finally have the technomages on our side, so the dragons move against the other ones?
You must remember, Lumos said, that for centuries we worked to come to terms with the threats of mages. Ever since the rebellion, dragons were wary. It took considerable time to get past that, and suddenly, every living dragon has seen Amy defeat multiple dragons with her power on TV. It's not exactly comforting.
Kristen didn't know what to do with that, other than work to find where the mages were so she could ensure they weren't being treated cruelly. Or worse, that they had already been killed.
Do we have any ideas where they could be?
Perhaps they took them to the prison where I was held?
Constance stepped forward and asked.
I know the technomages dispatched the guards, but that prison was both ample in size and well enchanted. I was not able to escape on my own. Other mages would be unlikely to be able to do so either.
Lumos waved his hand dismissively at the idea.
That location is compromised now. It's been a long time since a dragon prison was publicly discovered, but I can assure you the Dragon Council will have ordered it abandoned or demolished. Now that they are aware that it's known to technomages, they'll treat it as a liability, not an asset. Plus, with the dragon bullets, they'll have to assume some of the human governments know about it as well, and that has to be treated as a threat.
The woman looked shocked.
But it must have taken decades to build it and put in all those magic fortifications.
Centuries, more like, Lumos agreed. But you have the right of it. It represents a substantial loss to the North American Dragon Council. I'm sure they have at least one other prison on the continent, and it wouldn't be outside the realm of possibility to consider that the mages were sent overseas to another prison. I know there are at least a half dozen like this built around the world. The one in Antarctica is particularly difficult to access.
So you're saying we have no idea where they've been taken?
Kristen demanded.
They could be tracked, Atramento said sadly. If only their magic wasn't completely blocked. Like dragon auras, every mage has a particular style of magic, much like a fingerprint. I know those who were taken well enough to track them, but not with them cuffed like that. It's so cruel.
He shook his head.
Like putting earplugs and a blindfold on a person after years of loyal service.
Kristen's phone rang, and the screen flashed with the secure number of the Dragon Council. She cursed, then answered the call.
This is the Steel Dragon speaking.
You and your dragons are requested to report in person immediately.
She knew Brian had already verified the number, the voice on the other end, and the encryption on the call, so she could trust this was someone from the Dragon Council. It fit with the general rudeness anyway. After a grimace of irritation, she couldn't resist a little rudeness of her own.
Where exactly am I supposed to rush off to?
Her phone beeped, and she pulled it away to see that they'd sent her a location. It would be annoying if it weren't impressive. She told herself that the dragon on the other end probably had a team of techies helping her. Is this in response to what happened in Detroit? Because I assure you that situation is under control, Kristen said.
We wish to speak no further over this telephone connection, the dragon said disdainfully.
It might have been the leader of the Dragon Council herself, Shimmerclaw, but she couldn't tell because they obviously felt uncomfortable talking on the phone. We'll leave immediately, she said. The line went dead. Kristen sighed and rubbed her face. She was heartily sick of jumping whenever the council said so. But she saw no alternative. If all Dragon SWAT had been called away somewhere, it could only be the council's doing. They would likely know something about the mages. And then there was the issue of the masked one to consider. This was likely all his doing if, as Constance and Lumos both suspected, he was a member of the Dragon Council. Hopefully, she could find some clue to his true identity.
All right, dragons, we're up, she told the members of Dragon SWAT on the roof. I want you to round up the rookies, get them circling,
and for the love of Dragon's Fire, I want tight formations. The council needs to see we're as professional, if not more so, than any of their other forces.
For how long? Stonequest asked.
We'll leave in 10, she said, realizing what she had to do. It was time to put her full trust in both her new allies and the contract that bound them. I need to talk to Drew and Amy before we go. She found Drew in the streets below, helping rescue people from half-collapsed buildings. It pained her to pull him away from the work, but managing a group of former enemy mages was a task too important to leave to anyone else. So if anything goes wrong, contact Brian and he'll let me know. The contract should hold them, but I don't want to put all my faith in it, she said as she finished explaining the situation.
Yes, ma'am, Drew said.
Although between you and me, I think we lost the only one who wasn't committed to the cause. Most of the technomages seemed more than willing to defend regular folks from dragons.
That's good to hear, she said, before seeking Amy out. She found the mage clearing rubble as easily as a regular person might sweep the floor of crumbs. Amy, I'm going with the dragons. They asked for only dragons to come, but I'd feel much more comfortable if you'd come too.
Are you expecting trouble? The girl asked.
Not really, no, but I would much rather that you come with us to give me peace of mind. It would be better than you staying here and pissing these mages off any further. Remember, that contract binds all of us. That means you too.
I wouldn't do anything but show a couple of them how much stronger I am.
Please don't, she said.
Fine,
Amy replied, her expression sulky. The necessary orders given, Kristen retrieved her phone and called Brian.
Zed here. Go.
I need you to keep working on the mage problem, she said. We need to discover where they're being held.
Whatever you say, boss, but isn't that why you're going to the Dragon Council?
I hope so, she answered, but they ordered me there. That doesn't necessarily mean they want to give me answers. If they're not forthcoming...
We need to find them ourselves, he finished for her.
Right. I want to trust the dragons, but this mage-dragon rivalry is way older and far bigger than I realized. I want a location on these mages before the dragons decide to do something horrible to them.
You mean if they haven't already, he said.
Just find the mages, she ordered. Rather than dwell on the uncomfortable point he'd made, she changed into her dragon form and took to the skies to lead the other dragons on their trip to the Dragon Council. Chapter 9. Despite Brian checking and rechecking the location the Dragon Council had sent to Kristen, he still couldn't make sense of it. He told her as much as he spoke into an earpiece they'd devised for dragons to wear in flight so they could still use the magic that was cell phones. It appeared, and she could now confirm this in person, that the location was in the middle of Hudson Bay, north of most of Canada, and definitely north of the warm part. The problem was that it wasn't an island. It was merely a position somewhere in the northern part of the bay, far enough offshore that, as they flew across Hudson Bay, they saw nothing but glaciers. No land and no coasts were present to indicate anything that might suggest a dragon meeting. It was so cold that Amy, despite having the magical power to use her skateboard as a levitation device that flew as fast as any of the dragons, asked Kristen if she could ride on her back to warm herself on the hot scales of a dragon beneath her. She didn't mind, and thought it was probably smarter to have her riding instead of flying anyway. This entire war had become about mages, after all, and Amy,
despite having served her loyally, had killed two dragons at her home and fought off a couple more with her telekinetic powers in Canada. Much of that had been captured on camera, and all of it had made international news.
"Is it possible they want us to meet on a ship?" Kristen asked her dragons.
"I doubt it," Stonequest said,
although he didn't sound confident.
"Dragons aren't particularly trusting of tech, and boats totally count as tech." "I'm sure there's an island," Lumos said.
"But how could there be?" she asked. "Brian scoured the entire area via satellite. He found nothing."
"Human and dragon eyes can be fooled by means both magic and mundane," the old dragon said. "Do you think your electric eyes are different, even though they're much farther away?"
She snorted a laugh.
"I think it's a little ridiculous to think that dragons, beings who you said hardly trust tech, have managed to stop the entire planet from seeing..."
Kristen never finished her sentence as they flew into view of an island that, according to modern science, should not be there at all. As far as a location to hide on went, this one seemed a good candidate. It was tiny, hardly any larger than the squat, thick-walled castle that covered almost every part of its surface. Truly, more of the island seemed to be towering cliffs than actual land. Seabirds in great numbers clung to the cliffs, no doubt counting the days until they would depart for the south once more. Ice and frost coated the castle's walls, while snow dotted its ramparts. For a moment, it was lost in a mass of clouds. Kristen emerged from the clouds to find wings of dragon guards flanking her team.
"Hold your course!"
a dragon with a broken horn bellowed at her.
"No problem," she responded, as that seemed like the only reasonable thing to say, given that so many dragons were now in the sky around them.
Changing course would seriously risk a collision with at least one of them. Four wings, each with a dozen dragons, escorted her force of close to a dozen. They both flew on their left and right, above and below, so her team was boxed in. If the others chose to attack, she knew it wouldn't go well, especially since most of her force were dragons who had signed up to help fight with little combat experience.
"Land at the gate to the castle and take your human form. Any breach of the airspace above the castle will be taken as an act of aggression and will result in retaliation. Do I make myself clear?"
Again, Kristen answered with the obvious,
"Yep,"
and maintained her course. She couldn't help but feel relieved that she'd told Katrina to stay behind. Her thought was that the Iron Dragon might stay true to her word in Detroit, where she was surrounded by her allies and Kristen's shit-talking and endearing human friends. Here, though, she couldn't imagine her cooperating so easily. She descended slowly and landed at the gate in front of the castle, where she transformed into her human form once Amy climbed off her back. It seemed the young woman was wise enough to know to not use her magic powers at this particular juncture. The huge crossbows and massive javelins aimed at them made it quite clear that the dragons prowling the ramparts were more than ready to attack. One was there waiting for her.
"State your name and purpose," he said,
and his voice boomed despite being in his human form.
"Investigator Kristen Steele."
She held her badge out to prove it.
"Ah, it's so nice to see a fellow investigator," he said,
examined the badge, and extended his hand for a human-style greeting.
"They call me Sharpeye in English. Lady Shimmerclaw is expecting you. Your dragons are expected, of course. If you would all please follow me into the courtyard, refreshments will be provided for your human bodies to eat. We know the flight across the bay is a cold one."
His accent sounded like it was from the other side of the Arctic. He studied Amy.
"Your servant is welcome to eat in the courtyard too, although the food is cooked to dragon's taste."
Sharpeye smiled, but she understood the implicit threat. Come inside, stay in your smaller, weaker body while all these big, tough dragons in their dragon bodies watch you from the ramparts. If one of your people sneezes without permission, you're dead.
"Thank you,"
Kristen said, not sure what other choice she had. It was obvious they couldn't fight their way out of there, not without casualties. That left talking, which meant that, yet again, her people's safety was on her shoulders.
"Excellent."
He nodded and gestured for them to follow him inside. She darted one last look at her team. They seemed wary, but Stonequest gave her a small nod to tell her to continue. They had her back, whatever was coming. The gate was hauled open by two of the most enormous dragons she had ever seen.
It was made of iron, at least a couple of feet thick. I've never seen so many dragons in one place, Kristen said to Investigator Sharpeye once they'd left the rest of her dragons eating grilled seal and fish. His eyes twinkled. She wondered what he could see with a name like Sharpeye.
Indeed,
he sounded excited.
What you see is a gathering of all the fighting dragons of this continent. Nearly every member of the Dragon SWAT teams from across the country are here, as well as every investigator, plus a few informal militias as well. We even have a few dragons from the other continents to help balance our forces globally and better coordinate.
He sounded like he was describing a convention instead of a war band. Why are they all here? I would think they'd need to be in their stations, she said as they moved farther into the castle. The courtyard being open to the air made much more sense. Much of the structure was dug into the island and grew colder as the icy waters of Hudson Bay pressed in on the stone all around them.
Gatherings like this are happening on every continent except Antarctica, Sharpeye boasted. Soon, the dragons will strike and wipe out humanity's militaries and infrastructure. You and your forces have been summoned to join the fight. We still have dragon armor here from the last war. You'll be given first choice, and once you see the selection, you can choose other dragons who have served you well enough to have earned the right to wear it.
Kristen stopped dead in her tracks. I'm not here to enlist in a war against humanity.
Enlist?
His excitement gave way to confusion.
There is no enlisting in a war like this. You are dragon. You will fight with us. If you do not...
He left the sentence unfinished and smirked as if he knew full well there was no need to complete the threat. She didn't need him to tell her that her people would be killed. Knowing this would not be solved with Sharpeye, she took her badge out again. I demand to be brought to the Dragon Council. He looked wary.
Do you refuse your orders?
I do not refuse them, but this cannot proceed as planned without the information I must share with the Council. That is my right as an investigator, is it not? For the first time since they'd been talking, Sharpeye scowled at her.
That is your right, of course. Follow me. This way.
He spun on his heel and took her up a staircase and down a hall they had already walked past.
Here we are,
he said once they arrived at a pair of massive wooden doors inlaid with gold in the shapes of dragons laying waste to a town.
I will be outside, listening and watching.
She wanted to know how much he'd see from behind closed doors, but she didn't say anything. While she didn't much like this Sharpeye, she also didn't want him to regard her as a threat. Asking about the specifics of his powers seemed like a good way to make him suspicious. His name implied that he might have some kind of ability related to sight, though. With her shoulders back and her head high, she opened the doors and entered, ready to present her case for stopping, or at least delaying, war with humans. She was ready to face the 7 members of the North American Dragon Council, as well as members of the other bodies that governed other continents and provinces. But when she entered, most of the members of the Dragon Council weren't present. Only 3 dragons were there, and the first was the platinum dragon Shimmerclaw. The second was a dragon by the name of Lord Boneclaw. Kristen didn't know much about him, other than that he was one of the oldest dragons on the council. He was easy to recognize because of the scars on his face. He and Shimmerclaw were both old enough to be the Masked One, according to Lumos, anyway. While she had never met the third, she'd seen him before. He was massive, bigger than Shadowstorm, who'd been huge. She guessed he was more than 7 feet tall, with massive shoulders and arms as thick as most bodybuilders' legs. Although it was hard to tell, since he was seated in an ornate chair. Despite being in his human form, crystalline spikes protruded from his shoulders. He turned to face her, and his scowl was made cruel by eyebrows and a thin beard that seemed to both be made of crushed diamonds.
Greetings, Council,
Kristen said, and used her aura to communicate her confusion at only seeing 3 members when over 100 dragons were outside preparing for war.
You still speak to the full Council,
Shimmerclaw said, and gestured to a wide monitor and a camera set up on a tripod that was linked to the computer via a cable. It was extremely disorienting for Kristen to see a web camera and a group of attractive human-faced dragons looking at her in this ancient castle. communicating via carrier pigeon seemed more appropriate for their setting.
Investigator Steele, it's a pleasure to see you, even given the circumstances.
Shimmerclaw greeted her with a slight bow.
Thank you, my lady and lords. You honor me,
she replied and bowed deeply. Lord Boneclaw nodded in appreciation. He had a simpering, weak mouth that looked like it mostly wanted to agree with whatever had been said. The spiked dragon hardly moved his chin in greeting.
I must say I am surprised. I thought I was coming to find out about the whereabouts of the dragon SWAT members and the mages who were abducted from my city, she said, and focused on keeping her aura from making her seem accusatory.
No one was abducted,
Lord Boneclaw said quickly, with a glance at the other two dragons.
They were taken into protective custody. If the humans were clever, they could have bombed that building and all those mages would be dead. I still say they should be executed now, the other dragon said.
That would be an act of war, Diamantus, Shimmerclaw said.
We are at war, Diamantus retorted. The vote is cast and you and the other cowards lost. Now, Diamantus, this is no time to gloat or name call,
Boneclaw said through a plastic smile.
You voted for war too, Boneclaw. You no longer need to play the ambassador,
his colleague growled.
Forgive me, Kristen said and tried to sound like she meant it. But why would the council vote to go to war now? My team was successful on our mission. We finally stopped the technomages.
The scowl on Diamantus's face somehow grew even darker.
You've delayed the vote long enough, Shimmerclaw. The numbers are against you. We fly and they burn. What value is democracy if a vote is not honored?
What say you, Lord Boneclaw?
Shimmerclaw inquired of the weak-spined council member.
You know I didn't support rushing into this war,
Boneclaw said, and Kristen felt a wave of relief wash over her until he continued.
But the vote has been cast. I am concerned about setting a precedent of overturning a vote. Even if it seems the right thing in this particular situation, I don't think it would be wise to undo centuries of tradition.
A vote can be cast again if new information is available,
the woman said rather stiffly.
Lady Steele, how does your mission fare?
We don't have time for this, Diamantus raged. Our dragons are massing into armies and preparing for war with humanity. We cannot stop what has already been put into motion.
Shimmerclaw clenched her teeth at this, but rather than saying anything, she cast a look at Boneclaw. The thin, bony man with the scars on his face kept his gaze locked on Kristen. He still had the same agreeable smile on his face, but something hard was visible in his eyes.
I would like to hear what the investigator has done, he said.
It was the opportunity she had been waiting for. She exuded confidence with her aura and addressed the council, mindful that others watched her via the camera.
We have defeated the last of the mage cells. Their weapons have been confiscated, and we've recovered the dragons they had raised in their labs and used to make the dragon bullets. The fighting is over, and the technomages are finished. We don't need to go to war!
She couldn't help but sound excited at the last part. Hopefully, losing her composure for the sake of preventing war would be acceptable to the stiff-backed Dragon Council.
Well, this is excellent news indeed, Shimmerclaw beamed.
What of their leaders?
Boneclaw asked.
If even one of those at the top is free, they can simply retrain more mages.
Three of them, including Constance Vigil and the Iron Dragon, entered into a magical contract with me. They can no longer move against dragons unless they're defending regular humans.
That's poppycock,
Diamantus roared, although he looked intrigued.
No one has convinced a mage to sign a magical contract in centuries.
No one had, sir. I left the document in Detroit, but I assure you their leaders won't move against us.
And there were only the three?
Boneclaw asked.
One of them, a mage by the name of Neil Havington, refused to sign. He will be transported via ship with the other mages who wouldn't sign the contract.
The almost skeletal dragon nodded, as if he somehow expected this of Havington. but a moment later, his weak smile returned.
My congratulations on your successes and efforts. I know those mages must have greatly valued their dragon prisoners. I wonder at the wording of this contract, if you convinced them to agree to it, despite taking their source of weapons away from them.
The weapons are nothing to them. They simply used them to stand against a force they saw as unbeatable, Kristen explained quickly. They won't use them again. They can't, not with the contract I bound them to.
How marvelous,
Boneclaw said.
The investigator we put in charge of stopping these mages has now enlisted them for her. What exactly is the point of your force now that you've stopped the mages? Apparently to stand against an unbeatable force,
Diamantis roared as he pushed to his feet and displayed his full height. The massive human suggested how big he must be in his dragon form.
The steel dragon has never moved against dragonkind, Shimmerclaw said placatingly. She stopped the technomages to protect us. Truly, this is a boon, Lady Steel. I move to vote again based on this new information. This completely changes our calculations.
She turned to the camera and the other dragons who'd stopped whatever preparations they were making to watch the exchange.
But we have voted,
Boneclaw whined.
Perhaps this can change our tactics. But does this change the threat the mages have created by distributing the weapons to regular humans? Not at all.
Diamantis punctuated each word with a step toward Kristen. He towered over her, and his inhuman eyebrows and beard made him seem all the more intimidating.
Even without the terrorist cells, those bullets are still out there. They make humanity into a deadly threat that must be addressed.
I agree that the bullets are a threat, my lord, Kristen responded. My team has made the recovery of the dragon bullets our top priority now that the mages have been stopped. We've already recovered most of the bullets, and we're diligently working to find more.
They won't simply leave them where they would be easily located,
Boneclaw muttered. Of course not, sir. She studied him cautiously. He had seemed neutral when she'd first come in, and he was less overtly in support of war than Diamantis was. But he continued to make points that fueled the hulking, pissed-off dragon. But I have my best people examining the records the mages left with a fine-toothed comb, precisely so they can learn where those bullets have already been distributed to, and recover them. I have mages working on this, as well as humans skilled in computers. I assure you that, within the week, my team will have recovered all the bullets so they can be destroyed. Shimmerclaw looked relieved.
Well, this changes everything. This information completely alters the status of our relations with the world and warrants new discussion and a new vote.
No more bureaucracy!
Diamantis raged and kicked a chair with enough force to hurl it against a stone wall to shatter like kindling.
The vote is cast. You cannot undo it.
She shook her head, and her expression reminded Kristen of her mother chewing her brother out for raising his voice at the dinner table.
We have rules in place for reasons precisely like this.
But you can't simply wield them.
I can and I will,
she said, and addressed the camera behind her.
I was elected as head of the council by all of you. We will recess to consider this new information for a few hours, then reconvene. If all of you still feel we should go to war, we will of course honor the majority as we always have. But let me remind you that this could well kill many dragons. The previous times we went to war, we lost many of our greatest fighters. If there is no need for that now, must we still do so? I ask all of you to remember the Steel Dragon's record and consider how she has already helped us. I will see you all in 3 hours.
Diamantis looked furious at this decree, but most of the dragons on the screen didn't seem as enraged. Maybe it was merely that she could read the large dragon's aura and not theirs, but they seemed ready to discuss this turn of events. Kristen was thankful for that. She tried to look respectful and obedient as she watched the camera while all the dragons turned their connections off. They winked out one by one and left her alone with the three council members of the group that governed her continent.
Lady Steel, you have done well, Shimmerclaw
said.
I am sure that some dragons will not see the prudence of changing their mind to avoid this conflict.
Exactly, like some dragons didn't see the prudence of voting to stop these humans long before they achieved the capabilities they now possess.
Diamantis interjected with an obvious dig at the council leader. But, she continued, and her aura revealed no annoyance at being interrupted by him, some will surely see this as the blessing it is. I hope your cutting off the head of the enemy will change the minds of those dragons who still use theirs.
Thank you, my lady, Kristen said. You honor me.
Shimmerclaw gave her a slight bow. She recognized that for the gesture of respect it was supposed to be. Neither of the other two council members said anything immediately, so never one to be good at waiting for any amount of time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.